Good morning. Thanks a lot for tuning in to another episode of Art, Music, Technology. As always, I'm really excited to be able to bring these programs to you. This one, again, is brought to you by Splice.com. Splice.com is doing some really nice work in collaborative space. I know I use it for a collaboration project I'm currently involved in. If you're interested in doing it, you can help out the podcast, help keep all this stuff free by jumping over to Splice.com to our special location, which is splice.com/artmusictech-music. Kind of complex one. If you want, you can just jump over to the podcast site and I'll have a link there. Also, if you want to try out the Splice Sounds, which is an enormous library of loops and stuff, you can check it out. Use our code MUSICARTTECH, all one word, and that'll get you a free month. But in any case, thanks a lot for listening. Thanks to Splice for helping out. And please enjoy this discussion with Denis Labrecque. Okay, today I have a great opportunity to talk to somebody. I met him a little bit over the years. Actually got to spend a little more time with him recently around the NAMM show. But in general, I have always been kind of secretly a follower of this guy's work. His name's Denis Labrecque, and he has got the resume of resumes. Quite frankly, he's one of those guys that when you think of like the technologist part of art, music, and technology, he's there. He's been at like all the curves in the road, and so I'm really anxious to talk more about all that kind of stuff. So with that, let's say hi to Denis Labrecque. Hey, Denis, how's it going?
Good. Thanks, Darwin. It's going great. Thank you for having me on here and joining the rather amazing roster of folks you've interviewed in the past. I'm not sure I can keep up with on the technical side of things with some of those guys, but yeah, as you said, you know, we've met a couple of times along the way. It's amazing that we have not really met or talked much, given that our circle of friends intersect numerous times.
Isn't that crazy? Yeah.
I mean, there's all kinds of people that we both know. So many of which you've interviewed and a number of which show up on our respective LinkedIn and Facebook pages.
Yeah, indeed. Well, you had sent me a thing about a recent performance you did. And I was like, well, cool. Now I'm getting the third out of three in an interview, right? It's pretty great. So
yeah, you know, I think that, as you mentioned, there's just a, you know, you alluded to the fact that I've seen a bunch of curves. I'm one of the I'm one of the guys that has been there for a while. Maybe not quite as famous as some of the big name guys there, but I've been like the guy, you know, two or three people behind that guy. I am one of the dreaded folks in the music industry known as a marketer. It's funny, my sort of consistent joke is that engineers can do what engineers do, you know, without marketing guys. Marketing guys can't do anything without engineers.
Right. True enough.
So I've managed to attach myself to a number of rockets along the way. Quite honestly, I've been actually pretty lucky with some of the folks that I've worked with and some of the folks that I sort of crossed paths with over the number of years that I've been doing this. Yeah, so today, you know, it's actually kind of come full circle from what I'm doing. I'm consulting for the industry in general. I've got a number of clients that are doing some very interesting things. And again, I think it's mostly my recent success has been mostly because I just know a lot of people and have been able to kind of tap into a lot of different technology areas, whether it be software or hardware or user interface or communication, you know, just being able to get the word out on some of the cool things that that I've been working with. And then I think, you know, part of the sort of recent success is mostly because I'm a user. I'm a real fan of this stuff.
Right.
So I'm doing and have done the best that I can do at trying to help people make cool stuff that I can buy. So, you know, my collection of toys is growing, and I'm actually starting to use some of them occasionally these days. I'd say overall, if you're looking at sort of the big picture of what I've done, and it is just that. It has been trying to connect people that are making really cool technology to the people that are using that technology or can use the technology. Most recently, I've been with consulting for Analog Devices, which I had worked with in the past, working on their Shark processor stuff. Right. And it's just been, you know, really, really cool to be able to, one, help them internally kind of develop a platform that you can do some amazing things with. And then coming up is to be able to get that platform out to a number of developers. And we can talk a little bit more about that, you know, at some point here. So that's where things are kind of today. I still like music.
Well, you know, I actually think that's kind of a big thing, because sometimes, and I see it like when I go to the NAMM show, you know, I'll run across those 20-year vets, and you can see they're just done with it. You know, they've had enough.
Yeah.
Right. And you seem to still have just like the bubbling enthusiasm for the whole thing.
Yeah, I love it. I mean, I'm still searching out new sounds and new stuff. And it's really a question to me. It's a question of, well, have you done something different? Have you done something, you know, new? I love change. Right. I love things that change. My most recent, you know, sort of fun thing to listen to, I was turned on about a year ago to Caitlin Aurelia Smith. And I mean, she just does some wonderful stuff. She's sort of in the Suzanne Ciani mold. She actually did an album with Suzanne. You know, I remember some of the first things that really made me want to do, quote, this, you know, Silver Apples of the Moon, and of course Switched on Bach. And, you know, it's funny, I've been a very sort of fan of West Coast sound collage, soundscape stuff, yet most of my experience has been East Coast, you know, Moog style synthesis. So right. It doesn't matter. It's all music, and it's stuff that, like I said, somebody could be banging a plastic pot with an unusual hammer, and I'll go, oh, that's cool. I like that. So there's been, you know, as you said, I've done, you know, seen a whole bunch of things. And I guess starting, you know, back, and this will let people know how old I am here, but starting, you know, in the 70s, I mean, there's people forget that there was like a, you know, a whole 10, 12 year history of electronic music before MIDI,
right?
You know,
right.
And people were out there, you know, playing synthesizers and making electronic music well before computers got involved. So, you know, so that's kind of where I come from, starting out in the, you know, as a kid listening to Bob O'Reilly by The Who and going, how do he do that? That's not a guitar, you know,
right.
How do you do that? You know, and being very curious about how stuff was created, how stuff was produced. I did sound for my neighbor's rock band when I was in eighth grade, you know, twiddling the big PV knobs. And I've always felt, you know, fairly comfortable on that side of things, on the technology side of things. I've got a lousy left hand, so I was never, you know, never destined to be a great keyboard player. But I knew that synthesizers would give me a way to get things out of my head that I wanted to get out. You know, early 70s, there was a little company in northeastern Connecticut called Electronic Music Labs, or EML. I, you know, after high school, I went up and knocked on the door and said, hey, I want to learn this stuff. And they said, go away. Just go away. You know, just stop bothering us. And I would keep going back, you know, every couple of months, and they'd keep kind of shooing me away. They let me tour the, you know, the factory once. But it really wasn't until I got to college, had to take a musical instrument as part of the music program. And because I knew I wanted to be in the music program after I started in the engineering program and discovered an immovable object that was a calculus teacher. She had actually been censured the year before for failing over 60% of her students. She was a terrible teacher. So it really kind of turned me off to the, well, this is how I'm going to get into electronic music.
Right, right.
At the same time, I had a, you know, I had to take a, you know, music history class that a whole bunch of people had to take because they thought it was going to be an easy class.
Right.
And it turned out to be a brutal class that I loved, absolutely loved. Very interesting teacher. And very early on in the semester, he played Bartok's Concerto for Orchestra. And I went, oh, so there's something other than won't get fooled again. So anyway, the deflection to the music department happened, you know, very quickly after that.
Right.
But I had to take a musical instrument. It was part of the sort of the college thing where you had to have an outside instructor. So that was my key to get into electronic music labs. I knocked on the door and there was a gentleman there by the name of John Borovich. And I said, look, I really just want to, you know, I need to learn this stuff and I need the class credit. You know, can I pay you to teach me how to do this stuff? So he said, well, yeah, okay. And the first lesson was like, you know, an hour. I paid him the $15. The second lesson was about 2 hours. I paid him the $15. The third lesson, we started a band.
Right.
So
right.
Needless to say, I did get the college credit, but we formed a band using a whole bunch of EML gear and had a bass player and I mean, had a guitar player and a drummer. We're doing all sorts of weirdo quadraphonic electronic stuff. And it turns out that the guy that I had asked to teach me this stuff was one of the co-founders of Star Instruments. He left Electronic Music Labs. By the way, I still have my EML 101. It still works.
Oh, wow.
Which is amazing. So after that, you know, he and another engineer, two other engineers, started Synare Electronic Drums. For those of you in your audience who are way too young to remember this, Synare Electronic Drums was very interesting. This is pre-MIDI. People were starting to come out. You know, there was Moog and ARP and a few other folks around Buchla. You know, synthesizers were starting to be around. But no one had really done a drum thing. Moog had done a Moog drum thing. It was very expensive and had sort of limited use.
Right.
At Star, we decided that there was a sort of an untapped market for electronic drums. So we started building electronic drums somewhere in, you know, we were the first to use a microprocessor but somewhere along the way, someone discovered that it made this boo sound.
Right.
And started showing up on disco records. And pretty soon, anyone who was doing anything in disco had 1, 2, 3, 4 of these drums.
Right, right.
Now, we all hated the sound, quite honestly. It was just one of the sounds that the thing made. But at the same time, we went from, you know, 6 guys in a geodesic dome in northeastern Connecticut to 50 people literally a few weeks. Now, interestingly, live by the sword, die by the sword. And I recall this day pretty clearly. When God Save the Queen by the Sex Pistols came out, disco effectively died.
Right,
As did Star Instruments. No one wanted anything to do with electronic drums at that point. Literally, our sales went down by a factor of 10 within several months. You know, needless to say, we all started looking for other things to do. So one of the engineers from there, by the way, the guy that I had met, John Borovich, went on to then start a company with another one of the engineers, and that little company was called Passport Designs. Mm. Now, now we start getting into a really interesting technology area. But by the way, for the Star stuff, that was pretty much all analog. We'd actually used the Snare 3, which is one that made that infamous sound. The pickup for that was a speaker that was bolted to the back of a metal plate.
Oh, okay.
So we used the speaker like this little transducer kind of thing, and it would produce a little tiny voltage, and then we would use that to control the synthesizer.
Okay.
And as I said, you know, I'm not an engineer, but I've been around them long enough to kind of, you know, be it dangerous with some ideas. It was a cool idea. Anyhow, so Dave and John left, moved to California, and started you know, wanting me to join them. And at the time I was, let's see, running a 4-track recording studio, working in a record store, doing repair work for Star. And so I had 3 or 4 different jobs.
Right. The trickle of nickels that was really familiar to the electronic people at the time, right?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. You know, it's so it got to the point where it was like, well, you know, this guy in California kept offering me, he said, hey, you got to come out and do this because we're working with computers now. And there's this thing, you know, and Commodore just came out with this really cool, you know, Commodore 64. And we think we can make some music stuff with it. And but before that, it was the Apple II.
Right.
Now, the Apple II was cool in the sense that for many reasons, but one of the big things that really kind of helped make that go was the fact that you could pop the cover off and there were a bunch of slots inside and people were sticking cards into those slots and doing things. One of those companies was a company called Mountain Music, it was out in California somewhere.
Right.
And they made this sort of general purpose oscillator digital card. Dave Cusack, who started Passport, started writing some software for it, and we basically turned the Apple II into a synthesizer. And one of the jobs that I had when I was still in Connecticut was making the little interface card that plugged that into a keyboard. And okay. It was really interesting because, again, this is pre-MIDI. We were doing additive synthesis, 8-bit stuff, but it was very multiple envelopes, very sophisticated, very cool stuff on the expensive side. But, you know, we managed to get the attention of, you know, some academic folks and Laurie Spiegel and a few other folks that were, you know, sort of interested in what we were doing. And then somewhere along the way, built up a whole bunch of software, right? Things that we could record and then 1983 happened. For those of you, again, in your audience who don't know, you should. 1983 was the year for the invention of MIDI. And
everything changed.
Right. Everything changed. Everything changed very, very quickly. And Dave Cusack, being as astute as he was at the time, see, I like to associate myself with really smart people. Right. I can kind of, you know, work off the glow of smart people. saw what Dave had done and saw what was happening and went, yeah, we're getting out of the hardware business. Immediately. We're going to focus on this MIDI software thing.
Right.
So we wound up licensing a MIDI interface. Passport was the first company to ship MIDI software in the US. Almost all of the stuff that we had done on the recording and playback side of things for the Apple II, the Sound Chaser system, was then available as MIDI software. So we were the first company to get to kind of just jump into it and be able to record and play back and speed it up and slow it down and change the orchestration. And there again, the company went from, you know, a half a dozen people in an agriculture building in the middle of Half Moon Bay, California, to, 40, 50 people with a 40 by 40 booth at NAMM and Joe Zawinul coming by. And, you know, I mean, it was an amazing ride going from, you know, simple sequencing to Master Tracks Pro with multi-track sequencing and, right. And notation. And Encore grew out of that as well. We had actually had some notation software that ran on the Apple II. And then, of course, the Macintosh itself came out, which was the musician's computer at the time. So everything we had was, you know, ported over quickly to the Macintosh. And again, life changed very, very quickly. Mm-hmm. Encore was kind of unique in the sense that, you know, as a notation program prior to this, you know, there was nothing ever really existed where you could simply sit and play and see live notation.
Right.
The story I like to tell on that is to how, you know, technology changes things. One of the early users for Encore was Universal Film Studios down in Hollywood. Now, prior to, you know, using computers people actually sat down with, you know, pencils and rulers and wrote music. I know it's kind of hard, again, for people to understand, but they actually put those little black dots on a piece of paper with a pencil. And they would get a tape in from a composer. They would transcribe that tape by ear, by hand, convert it to, you know, notation and blow it out as a orchestral piece of music, and literally, you know, walk it down or courier it down to the recording studio where an orchestra would play this stuff. And if there were any changes, if anybody wanted to do anything different, the conductor would stop everything, stop the orchestra, make a few notations. They'd send it back down to the guys in the print room. They would make those changes and send it back. And it, you know, it was this long process to put an orchestra on a piece of film. When we went down there, we were invited down there. They had gotten an early version of Encore, and they said, well, would you like some feedback on this? And we said, sure, because, you know, we didn't know anything about notation. I mean, right. we knew how to get the notes from, you know, what it sounded like or what it's supposed to sound like to dots on a screen. But one of the first things that the Universal guys told us was that, yeah, but that's not notation. That's just writing notes down.
Yeah.
There's a huge difference between what is actually on the page and what needs to be on the page and a MIDI file, for instance. So long story short, they would start getting now MIDI files in from people. They would transcribe them and then send them down. If they needed to make any changes, they can make changes instantly. We started putting stuff in the program that would do things like, you know, they would tell us, well, you know, for this violin passage, all these 16th notes at the bottom of the page, you can't do that.
Right, right.
Because the violin player can't turn the page while
they're doing 16th notes, right?
And it's like, huh, you know, I mean, all this stuff that we never would have thought of in right. a real world application, right?
Right, right.
So we started building algorithms in that would take, okay, well, if it was too dense at the bottom of the page, we would just shove all that stuff to the top of the next page. And they loved us for it. I mean, they loved us. So they actually told us that we enabled them to go from doing a score every 3 weeks to 3 scores a week.
Holy cow.
And so in terms of productivity and their job security, they loved us, right?
Right, I mean, right.
But again, as you realize, you know, what that did was that really fundamentally changed the way orchestral music and music for movies was made. Now, it wasn't just us. There was other people came in, and this Finale is a tremendous program, and there was a bunch of other stuff. But the idea that technology really changes the way people think about what they're doing, right? Because now you could do things like, for my own playing, right? I'll sit down in front of a sequencer and I'll just play stuff, right? I'll just kind of randomly do stuff. And, you know, 1 out of 10 little musical things that I do is interesting. Well, prior to MIDI, I, you know, would have recorded stuff and I would have literally gotten out of, you know, tape splicing. And it was just too much of a pain in the butt to do that. So I would just not do it or just keep trying to do it.
Right.
With MIDI, I could go, okay, yeah, these 3 bars, man, out of the 300 that I played, there's something here, you know, let me take this, and I would double it and I would orchestrate. So it really allowed me with, you know, fairly lousy left hand technique, but a few interesting ideas to make music. Right. Now, one of the things, of course, the downside of that, and I've actually stood in front of, you know, racks and racks and racks of synthesizers and computers. And one of my first lines generally, if I'm teaching any of this stuff, is all of this stuff has made it incredibly easy to produce bad music. Because it is. And, you know, I mean, right. And there's always the doubt, you know, there's always the dark side of technology, right? The downside of technology, you can,
right.
you know, throw your hand on a keyboard, let the arpeggiator go for 25 minutes and, you know, call that music. But, you know, the good stuff always rises to the top. There's always a side of the technology that inspires or changes or allows somebody to do something that they could never do before. And then somebody else, you know, sort of catches on that. And then it's like, okay, well, now I can, you know, I can go in this direction. I can do some interesting things here. It's really been very interesting to kind of be, even in some small part, you know, sort of behind that. And then as a user, you know, for these companies, some of these companies that I've worked for, I was always the guy, again, the non-engineer guy, who would ask questions like, well, yeah, can you record like a bunch of channels on the same track? And then and they were like, no, you can't do that. And then, you know, one engineer would go, well, yeah, you can do that. Or, you know, gee, can I put the EQ before the reverb, you know? And, you know, again, a lot of times I was met with, you know, engineering sort of challenges and them saying, well, no, why would you want to do that?
Right.
I says, well, can you do it? Yeah, of course I can do it. Well, then let's try that, you know?
Right, right.
So again, you know, I can't claim that I've invented any, you know, any real super special things. Well, I had a couple of things in MasterTrax Pro that were interesting, but just the idea of bringing outside ideas to engineers. You know, one of the problems that I've encountered over the many years is engineers tend to be very, you know, whether software or hardware, tend to be very solitary, at least the good ones. You know, it's all their ideas. And, you know, some of these guys just don't get out enough. They make these really cool things. You know, like I want to strangle the guy who developed the display for the DX7. It's like, you know, really? You expect me to do this with that?
Right.
You know, but again, I understand, you know, there's also the limitations of the time, of course, right? You see, you know, that's all you had to work with was a little two-line display, because if you wanted to do anything bigger, the instrument would have been $10,000.
Right.
You know, so there's always those trade-offs. But at the same time, you know, like the Universal Audio thing, you know, until you really kind of get out there in front of actual users of this stuff, you can have a dozen, two dozen really great ideas that just don't gel, that just don't manifest themselves in something that's really useful for whether it be a performer or someone's, you know, composing or whatever. So I would always like to think, at least, that I always played devil's advocate in terms of, well, can you make that a little easier? You know, can I do this with one click instead of four? Dave Kusek at Passport was a big, I learned a lot from Dave. He was a big proponent of that. It's like, I don't really want to have to think about the computer. I want to play, right? So if I can do things easier or simpler.
I want to ask you some questions, though, because this, when I look at your history, Passport is, I mean, you kind of grew up there. I mean, you were there for quite a while, but also the whole industry grew up there while you were there as well. I mean, you started off, I remember I had a little recording studio in Denton, Texas. A guy showed up with one day and he had like, he was hauling boxes out of his car, and the first one was an Apple, and then the second one was a keyboard and like a musical keyboard. And I was like, how did those two things go together? That doesn't even make sense. You know, that's like, you know, a dog and a frying pan, right? The two don't go together. And then, you know, he brought in a couple of manuals and a monitor, and he set it up, and he wanted to record these things on and get them prepped for a release. And we were like, okay, whatever. And he started hooking up, and we just kind of stood and watched, and our jaws dropped when we kind of saw what the future of music was going to look like, right? With that, you know, he had a Passport design system. He had a sound chaser system, and we were floored. We had never seen anything like it. Now, that was like the first jaw drop in a series of jaw drops that seemed to happen like every month when a magazine came out. We'd open it up and there'd be a whole new set of jaw droppers, right?
Yep. Yeah, it was great to chase all this stuff too, you know? Whatever we started or had a part in starting, looking at, you know, we would always look at, oh, did you see what those guys did? Let's do that too. You know, we can do that. I mean, it was amazing. It was amazing.
We could
amazing
do that stuff. And some of this too. Right.
Right.
Exactly.
Right.
The thing that's interesting to me, though, is the way that with Passport, they seemed really adept at sort of surfing the changing tides, right? Where you talk about, like, with Star, it's sort of like, Well, disco's done, and nobody's playing the theme song from Love Boat anymore, so I guess we're done.
Yeah, we're done now.
But with Passport, I mean, they started off in one thing, sort of improbable, but they made a go of it, and next thing you know, they are shifting, and kind of like shifting on an annual basis, it seems like. What was that like, and how hard was it to navigate those waters? How hard was it to look at things and say, this is an area to pursue, or that looks like a dead end to me? Or did you just try them all and just stick with the ones that actually sold?
Yeah, it was chaotic. It was interesting because as the company grew and as life went on in the, you know, in that late 80s, early 90s, you know, it started as half a dozen friends that wanted to do something cool with music, and it turned into a business, right? Right. With HR issues and insurance and, you know, I mean, honestly, it really got, I mean, that, not that, you know, and accounting and investors and, you know, so, you know, we did, Passport did what a whole bunch of other companies did at the same time. And then it was like, well, gee, in order to do this, we need more money. You know, let's sell off this part of the, you know, let's sell part of the company. Let's get investors. And, you know, and that really kind of changed things, right? We were now responsible, you know, and the other thing, of course, we were literally and physically growing up, right? Because now we had kids and we had, you know, and life, and, you know, so instead of just a bunch of people that were like, well, let's see, you know, if we don't make payroll next week, then we'll just have to skip a week, ha, 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 to, oh, the investors, a couple of million dollars. Okay, well, then we better make something that is going to have mass appeal, you know.
Right.
So, you know, we did derivative versions of the stuff we were doing, and we actually, Passport actually, and this is not terribly well known, we actually kind of went off and two things that we did, one that was very forward looking that didn't work, two things that were very forward looking that didn't work. One was we had a sub company called Music at Passport, and we decided to get into the MIDI file business. So we were selling MIDI files and we were licensing music and paying royalties, and you know, it was a very difficult thing to do because, first of all, the record companies really didn't understand what a MIDI file was. And so the royalties, and it was just a mess. It was just this big mess. But the other thing that we did, again, that not a lot of people remember, we actually started a media company. We had a program called Producer. And Producer was a media sequencer. We decided to leapfrog everybody at the time, in the late, you know, sort of mid-90s. The competition was starting to add audio, right, to MIDI.
Right.
And with some amazing stuff. I mean, the you know, Vision was just an amazing program. And, you know, I mean, and we were going to, but we decided that we wanted to go beyond that. We wanted to do something different. And so we came up with a program called Producer. Now, Producer was a media sequencer, and it could take any media type, MIDI file, audio file, video file, and sequence it along a timeline. And nowadays, you don't think of any, you know, you think of, you know, you think nothing of that, right? I mean, you can do that within Logic and all these other programs. But there was nothing like it. The closest thing we had that there was a program from Macromine called Director.
Called Director, yeah. I was wondering if it was like somehow related to that.
Yeah. So it was Director. We decided to call ours Producer, you know. and I remember actually being on stage. It was a shootout. It was at some small conference somewhere, and it was a shootout between Director and Producer to produce a 3-minute piece that used audio, video, and music. And I just smoked the guy. I mean, it was just apologies if you're the guy out there. I don't know, but I had mine done in minutes. It was all visual based. It was timeline based. Unfortunately, at the time, you needed like the biggest, baddest Mac tower you could find, you know, with
back when that was $10,000.
Yeah, exactly. So our audience was very, very small. And we tried pricing it at $1,000 and we sold a whole bunch. We tried pricing it at $200 and we sold the same number, so because again, it was the audience itself was extremely limited, right, in terms of who could actually access this technology.
Sure.
So before we run, too much into overtime, sort of the next inflection point after all this software stuff was I really kind of wanted to get back into hardware. And I was seeing sort of the end of Passport. The way I like to put it was I saw the light at the end of the tunnel, and it was a train heading straight for us. we missed the boat on adding audio. A little company called, DigiDesign had just come around, and the focus was clearly shifting from MIDI and a whole bunch of synthesizers back to digital audio.
Right.
Back, because memory was cheaper and computers were better and, all this technology, for whatever reasons. I got an interesting, matter of fact, I was at an AES show, which again shows you the power of kind of just hanging out sometimes. Hanging out at the back of an AES show, looking at the job board, and saw this interesting posting from a little company in Scotts Valley called Emu Systems. And they were looking for somebody, and they read down the list of stuff, and it was like, huh, that's my resume. and they were looking for somebody with some hardware experience, some software experience, experience in music, and I was like, oh, okay, yeah, I got all that.
Right, right.
So I went down and I got the job, and this was after they had been acquired by Creative Labs. So it was sort of the middle period of our late middle period of Emu. I was actually kind of closely aligned with what they were doing on the chip side for Creative. Mm-hmm. So they had Dave Rossum and the absolute rocket science geniuses that were at Emu at the time were making their own chips, right? I mean, that's one of the things that, again, a lot of people don't really fully realize about Emu is that Emu was able to do what they did because they made their own chips.
Right.
They actually made their own digital engines. They made an engine for Creative Labs called the 10K1. Creative took it and put it on a Sound Blaster and was just selling the living daylights out of the Sound Blasters. And a couple of folks at Emu said, well, we've got this chip. We have the rights to all of this stuff. Would you like to help develop, our own card? Now, remind you, this is at the time when like the Emulator 3 was out, the Emulator 4 was coming out, right. These, $4,000, $5,000 big machines that could do amazing, amazing things. I was chartered with, coming up with a $500 sound card. Now, I got a tremendous amount of support internally from the engineering team. The sales team, however, really didn't want this thing to come out. Or certainly not come out at $500,
right?
So they were still selling and getting commissions
on
$4,000 emulators. And, at the time I remember talking and sort of arguing with the sales guy saying, well, yeah, but this is coming. This all in the box, all in the computer thing is coming, guys. You really should back me up on this. And like I said, the engineers were all for it. It did okay. I mean, we won an award from Electronic Musician Magazine, and it was basically a multi-channel emulator on a card. But it didn't get the push. It didn't get the promotion. In my opinion, anyway, that it could have or should have gotten. And then the Giga Sampler came out, and all of a sudden, everybody in Hollywood dumped all their emulators and bought big computers. Now, again, I'm sort of overstating this to make a point, but again, the technology changed the industry, right? Now it was the computer now becomes the instrument. It's interesting to me that we're kind of still in that phase to some degree. Now, I'm a huge supporter and a huge fan of what's happening with Eurorack instruments, and I've got a little Eurorack setup that I know which end of a soldering iron to hold. I mean, I can do some, I can still do some stuff.
Nice.
You look at the way things have changed, in the computers themselves, where you can do, everything in the box. although you're still kind of running it through the same converters, but that's a whole separate discussion. No matter how many different instruments you have, you're ultimately still running them through the same converters. Converters do make a difference. So I got to the point of where I was actually using multiple computers. I would have a virtual instrument, you know, on each of five different computers, right?
Okay.
With different interfaces and stuff. But that's, again, that's a different discussion. But to go from there, you know, to go from the making the sound card thing, went back into software. Some people that I know from Stanford Karma started this company called Staccato Systems. And the long story short there is Staccato wound up developing a software wavetable synthesizer that Analog Devices decided that they were going to ship with their PC codecs. Now, the interesting thing there, and someone actually credits me with this, I can't say that I take full credit or even a lot of credit for this, but when Analog Devices started shipping their SoundMax line of codecs for PCs, they started shipping this software along with it that essentially turned the PC into a sound card, effectively killing the sound card market. You know, there was no real reason after around 2002, 2003, there was really no reason to buy a Sound Blaster because you could do all your game audio inside the computer.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the inside the computer part came from Staccato Systems. I think it was one of the last acquisitions that happened in the year 2000 in Silicon Valley, because before everything kind of fell apart.
Right. The wheels came off right after that.
Definitely came off. But Analog Devices made their money back on that acquisition very easily. Analog Devices wound up being in about 85% of the motherboards that were shipped between, 2001 and 2005.
Believe me, I remember making sure that my SoundMax drivers were up to date because, that would always be the key to even more performance, right?
You're welcome. So I was the product manager for SoundMax.
Okay.
Again, several people to this day say that, I helped kill the sound card, but it wasn't conscious. It wasn't a deliberate thing. But, at Analog, I moved from there to the DSP division and again got even more and more sort of corporate in terms of dealing with chips and things. And there I was sort of a general purpose marketing guy. DSP at the time that the Sharks and the Blackfin, products were developed, were really general purpose devices. You could look at a list of attributes. High channel count, high frequency resolution, number. And until you got to like bullet number 10 or 11, you could either be making a synthesizer or a medical device.
Right, right. Of course. And,
or a predator drone. All of the things that are required for making really cool effects processors and instruments are really kind of the same things for the most part that people wanted for general purpose DSP.
Okay.
So the Shark came about, and I, of course, had constantly demonstrated my affection and ability to, be the music guy, and started to really sort of help out with getting those processors in the industry. I convinced them to send me to NAMM, kind of thing. As the chips got more interesting and better and cheaper, I started widening the circle, and I would, I'd go to the shows and I'd say, hey, you guys really, look at this stuff from Analog. It's kind of interesting stuff. And I wasn't a sales guy, but I was, Apple used to call them evangelists, right?
Right, right. Well, you were like a technical earworm. You would stick something in their head and hope that it hatched.
Yeah, and some of these guys would just desperately wanted to get me out of their heads. So, but at the same time, I started talking to some very, very interesting people again. And this is mostly, again, a lot of the people that I had known from other lives, right? The people over at Universal Audio, which of course grew out of EMU and a bunch of other folks in the Bay Area, they started using DSPs for this sort of new technique of stuff called modeling.
Right.
Again, many of your listeners probably know the Universal Audio story. If not, they should. Well, you know, little company out in Scotts Valley grew into this just amazing, amazing company on the strength of very, very heavy duty signal processing. Modeling has always been something that I've been very interested in. The Staccato guys were doing modeling stuff, and circling back, the analog stuff just got bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger to the point where they said, well, you really should be like the pro audio business development guy, you know. So anyway, spent a bunch of years doing that, and sort of got back into directly into the industry when I started my own company a few years ago. That kind of brings us up to, you know, the last couple of years.
Yeah. There's so much to talk about there. I'm curious though, one of the key things, and you use this phrase yourself, but one of the key things of what you've done is that you've been the music guy around engineers. What does that actually represent? I mean, is it literally the person who brings outside influence, or is it more hands-on, or is it more engineering than that? What does that dance look like?
Great question, actually. It's a little of all of the above. It's, you know, knowing enough, but not too much about how stuff is done. From an engineering perspective, to ask really stupid questions that sometimes trigger something. It's like, well, how come you can't do that? because of it. Well, you know, maybe you can. And again, bringing that sort of real world musician, hey, I'd like to be able to do this thing, you know, to the table. You know, engineers know what they know, and you know, there's a vast pool of people that have a tremendous amount of intelligence and ability, yet there's still things they don't know, right? And one of the things perfect example. I mean, we're developing this thing at Analog, and it's essentially a sound card with a DSP on it. And it's like, you know, it's got, you know, eighth inch connectors and a bunch of other stuff on it and stuff. And I said, well, gee, why don't we have it, you know, can we make it so that it's expandable so that somebody who wants to build something on top of this can do this easily? Oh, yeah, sure, we can do that. You know, that was an easy thing. And I said, okay, well, let's make an expander. And let's put, you know, quarter inch balance connectors on it. Oh, yeah, we can do that. And let's put like 5-pin DIN MIDI jacks on it. Oh, so what's that? Oh, well, MIDI is, you know,
and I go, synthesizer. Yeah,
I don't fault that engineer because they're not music people, right? Or I shouldn't say they're, none of them are, but you know, many of them are not. But it was a simple thing. And then, you know, so now I've got a half a dozen engineers that are just totally turned on my MIDI.
Right.
It's like they're asking me, oh, what interfaces should I buy? Should I get another keyboard? Should I get, you know, but it's really, you know, I guess I'm still struggling to actually answer your question here. I think what I bring to the table sometimes is that, hey, have you thought about this thing?
I think there's also something to be said for turning people onto stuff, right? I mean, one of the things about engineers is in order to get to the level of depth that it needs to do something innovative, a lot of times you have to sacrifice the breadth of getting to experience a lot of the world. And so I think bad analogy here, but being like the drug dealer of different technologies actually is a way that you can really service engineering in a very interesting way. You can open them up to new influences, give them an opportunity to maybe see something differently or see something from a different angle.
Yeah. And it, you know, in a little ways, even beyond that, and just make make them aware of something from another discipline or from analog devices has got a gazillion parts, right? And I was actually just shown, it's like, hey, you know, I'm using this analog device's Digipot. And it's like, we make Digipots? That's kind of cool, you know? So, you know, being able, because I've been, you know, very focused on the DSP side of things. And now Analog just acquired another company, Linear Technology, here in Silicon Valley. And they make all these really, really interesting, you know, power management things, right? Mm-hmm. That I know there's a bunch of guys in the music industry would love to see this stuff. You know, you can't know everything. I mean, as try as you may. So that's what I like to think that I bring is, hey, you know, I might not know a whole lot about this, but I know a bunch about this. Right. And have you seen this? And it goes to just, you know, again, me looking at the industry, following the industry, talking about, I was actually talking to somebody the other day about, hey, this thing that this Eurorack thing is doing, it's really kind of a cool thing. You know, did you see this? Yeah, I think that's what I like to think that I bring is just sort of this independent view of the musical world and how things can be used. And of course, you know, I drag along my absolute sense of wonderment and amazement and astonishment as to how engineers can do what they do.
Right.
You know, I mean, I look at code, I look at, you know, C code, and I go, yeah, okay, that's great. Can you make it? can you make it do this? Even to the point now, and I'll sort of finish with this stuff, kind of bring you up to speed on the last things. I'm working with a company called Molforte, and these are the guys that developed the GeoShred program for Jordan Rudess's company.
Yeah, amazing, you know, amazing product. Yeah.
Physical modeling on an iPad and the controllability, what you're able to do with your finger on a piece of glass, amazes me. And for them, there wasn't a whole lot I could do because they just done it. It was an amazing thing. But I did look at some of the user interface stuff, and I actually threw in a bunch of sounds. I did some sound design. So if you do play with the program, all of the really, really interesting and subtle guitar sounds, I didn't do any of those. A bunch of the really bizarre, non-musical noise things, those are mine.
there's your love of the West Coast sound coming right back, right?
Exactly. And again, I certainly can't take credit for, you know, I've got a half a dozen sounds in there. But again, it's part of the sort of expansion and, you know, of how people make music. You know, people say, well, are you a Eurorack fan? And I said, well, yeah. And I'm a fan of the Prophet X, and I'm a fan of, you know, the iPad, and I'm a fan of a tin can and a rubber band. You know?
Right.
It's whatever you need and can use to do what you do, to express what you express.
One of the things I'm curious about is that, or I'm interested in, is understanding how you keep up. Because one of the things I say, you have, I mean, given that your career spans EML to now, and what do you do to stay on the front end? Because I have to tell you, I've interviewed an awful lot of people, and sometimes people who've been in the game for a long time, there was like a point at which their curiosity shut off. And, you know, they're like, oh, yeah, I've heard about this digital modeling thing or whatever, because they just don't care. They stopped caring, right? You seem to have an endless fascination with this stuff, and I'm wondering, what do you do to kind of maintain that, and where do you go to keep on learning more?
I get up very early. that's actually part of it, and somewhat more truthful than not. Back when I was started working at Analog Devices, they're a company that's based out of Boston, so I started keeping Boston hours. So I get up at 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning, and I read and look all the time. You know, I do have a fascination with technology. I have a fascination with new sounds. I try to listen a lot. I try to really keep my fingers in a lot of different areas. But I listen to blogs. I listen to interviews. I read. I'm one of those few people that actually reads manuals, you know, and to keep up, you know, I try to sort of randomly listen to stuff, right? I'll go to SoundCloud or I'll go to, and I do try to, you know a lot about the industry. I, you know, I've got a lot of friends that, you know, that turn me on to stuff. My son is great because, you know, occasionally he'll borrow my car and leave a CD in the car. And it's like, who are these guys? Oh, that's Little Dragon. Oh, that's cool. You know, I think it does go back to just my overall amazement and wonderment of musicians, of sound, of sound, just sound, maybe not even music, but sound. You know, sounds have always allowed me to kind of go into different places, right? And it's like I hear something that's like, how's that made? One of the first things I did, I got a Pro 2, the Sequential Circuits Pro 2. Right. And there's some amazing sounds in that instrument. And there were a few, it's like, holy crap, how is that possible? How is that sound possible with this architecture? So I would sit, I saw, there was one sound called Plunkett. So I'm not sure who did it. It might have been Robert Rich, or, you know, it was Richard Devine, or one of those cool guys. Right. And I sat with it for about 2 hours tearing it apart. It was like, okay, well, all right. So they've got all four delay lines. Go, okay, that's cool. So I think, you know, I don't know if there's an adequate answer to your question. I'm just a curious guy. Music has been what I've wanted to do since my, you know, eighth grade neighbor's rock band. And I think that where I go to Synthtopia, I go to, you know, your blog, I go to, I read, you know, Dave Rossum's stuff, even though I don't understand most of it. and I think, and that's part of it too, is I challenge people to read stuff that they don't understand. One of my, when I was, cause I just do sort of general consulting sometimes. One of the people that I consulted for makes chips for solar systems. So I just read everything I could about how solar energy is made and what, you know, how you can, you know, how, what arc fault detection is, and, you know, all of that sort of keeps my brain moving in a direction. I love learning stuff that I don't understand and trying to understand it. But I do go, you know, I'm online a lot. Again, especially early in the morning, I'll go down those rabbit holes of listening to things and checking out people's podcasts. And, you know, sometimes it'll stick, sometimes it won't. But, you know, I believe it or not, actually subscribe to a whole bunch of, you know, people don't like junk mail. I love junk mail. I love junk from places that I've wanted, you know, not necessarily from, you know, Macy's or Nordstrom's, but I'm on every manufacturer's mailing list, you know, and I try to follow the instruments. I try to follow the, you know, how things are done, and of course the trade shows, right? That's how I got into the Eurorack thing. Is I just started seeing some innovation, and I have to say, for those folks out there that are dismayed at the state of music or how things are being done, or, you know, whatever industries they're in, I talked to some of these folks that are making the Eurorack things, for instance, and just absolutely blown away by the level of knowledge and passion of these, you know, 20 somethings that have just designed this really cool non-linear fraculating circuit, you know. And yeah, they'll tend to go on and on and on until you really need to stop them about, you know, how they designed this thing. But I'm still amazed and delighted at the fact that they've done it. Right. It's like, here's yet another generation of people that look at something and go, yeah, I could do that. Or yeah, I could do something different. You know, that's how I started. I mean, and associating, if there's any other piece of advice, just hang out with smart people, you know, just try to hang out with people that are smarter than yourself, because you'll learn a lot.
Yeah, well, it's that old band thing of you're going to learn the most if you're the crappiest player in the band, right?
Yes.
A lot of times with learning things, it's like be the dumbest guy in the room and being willing to ask the dumb question, because so often those are the ones that swing doors yep. open too.
Yeah, right? See, I have no problem with that. My big thing there is, you know, there are no dumb questions. There's a lot of dumb answers, but there's no dumb questions.
Right. So unfortunately, our time is up, but yep. I've got to ask you, I mean, you're a guy who has watched the whole industry grow from atomic to what it is today. So you have kind of the ability to like place the ruler at one end, place the center point where we are now. What does the other end of the ruler look like to you? Where is all of this stuff going? What do you think? I mean, is it converging to one thing? Is it diverging into 10 million things? And what are the areas that most excite you?
Again, a good question and a tough question. You know, you sort of can't avoid the whole IoT, you know, Internet of Things wave that's happening now, right? With everything being interconnected to everything else. You know, wireless technology is, I think, still in its infancy to some degree. More and more, you know, truly and totally wireless, synchronized, underlying synchronized things, which is one of the things that's sorely lacking in wireless technology for the most part. I'm still waiting for new forms of synthesis to kind of take hold. For as much as I am enamored by the Eurorack and current synthesize, you know, crop of cool, cheap synthesizers, I'm getting really, really tired of the two oscillator filter envelope generator thing. Right. You know, so I do see alternate controllers. I do see different forms of synthesis, you know, someone finally really taming physical modeling, really taming granular synthesis, combining all of that into one big synth engine kind of thing. And, you know, it's funny because you even look at the Eurorack stuff and it was, you know, pure analog, right? Just, right. If you didn't burn your fingers on the soldering iron, you know, and now the really innovative stuff is digital. Yeah. Right. So, you know, the hybrid things, you know, I think, speaking of hybrid, the new sequential, right? The Prophet X, which is a sampler synthesizer. So samplers, you know, kind of had their, you know, had their big heyday, right? And they kind of went away and now, you know, maybe there's another trend, you know? So I think that, you know, looking at sort of a unified synthesis thing for the industry will be happening at some point. It's hard to say how, you know, as far as the music quote industry goes, boy, it's a tough time to be a musician unless you're, you know, Katy Perry. But I do see, you know, some glimmer of hope there as well. I see more people playing live. I see, you know, something will come out of the Eurorack desktop noise that's happening now. And I say noise in an affectionate way, but there, you know, the ability to craft sound is kind of coming back. And I see that as happening. You know, the old story about the first couple hundred Prophet 5s that went back to the factory didn't have any of the presets changed. Right. I see that changing, even with the instruments getting more and more and more complex. Certainly computers are not going to go away. They're going to get smaller and cheaper and faster and better, and iPads and other types of, well, as I said, alternate controllers. This whole MIDI MPE seems to be bringing, you know, breathing another life into MIDI again. You know, MIDI is important again. And then audio and sound in general, you know, the whole, I've kind of kept my ear to the ground, no pun intended, on voice input stuff, you know, the whole Alexa, Amazon Echo, you know, being able to talk to something and get a response. Wouldn't it be great to have a keyboard where you're playing it and, you know, you're playing live and you press a little button and you speak into a microphone and say, hey, yeah, I need to be a little bit brighter, you know, and that changes the filter for you. That's doable, right? It's doable now. Yeah. You know, it's not there yet, but it's the blending of technologies And as I said, I think wireless is got some very interesting things to go. I think voice input has some very, very interesting places to go.
Well, Denis, I want to thank you so much for giving us a nice run through your history, but kind of the history of the industry, but also your insights into things as well. I look forward to bringing you back and teasing even more of that. We're going to try and book something soonish because I think you have such great vision for things like helping people get into working with tools, introducing people into new concepts and new ways of attacking problems. And I just find that endlessly interesting and super powerful. So I want to have you back again soon.
No, I was going to say, I'd love to. The project that I'm working on right now with Analog is going to be released in the September-October timeframe, and I'd love to do a session just on that because there's a lot of potential for that project to be very, very interesting for the industry.
So I'm looking forward to that. We will talk then. And in the meantime, I'll let you have the rest of your day. Thank you so much. I appreciate
all right.
it.
Thank you, Darwin. And again, thank you and the folks out in the on the wires, on the pipes of the internet here to allow me to talk, because that's what I do pretty much all the time.
There you go, man.
All right. Thanks, Darwin. Have a great afternoon.
Thank you. All right. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Okay, many thanks to Denis. That was quite a rollick through the history of music technology. The guy has been in the middle of it all, and especially that work with Passport. I mean, if you think about the process of going from Apple II computers to the Mac, through the kinds of changes he would have seen there, but also to get involved in the hardware end of things as well as the software, pretty amazing opportunity to surf the whole music industry. And it was great to kind of get what it was like going through all that. So thanks to Denis for that. Thanks for you for listening. Thanks to Splice.com for their support of the podcast. Thanks to Synthtopia, CDM, and all the other people that are keeping the faith out there. Really appreciate the work that they're doing. With that, I will catch you next week. Bye.